as responsibility to the Gila River Indian Community instead of mismanaging funds and assets and inaccurately documented boundaries and rights of way, which have caused a lot of problems here. A more earnest attempt to initially treat these tribes and tribal people with the respect that they deserve and with an attention to detail, fairness, and transparency could have avoided many of these situations altogether. While I'm happy that we get a chance to right these errors, I urge the administration and Interior Department to not repeat the mistakes of the past and be a bit more diligent, honest, upfront in their current and future dealings with tribes and tribal people. Real people are affected by their actions or inactions. Mr. Chairman, I want to thank the sponsors of both bills for bringing these issues to our attention, and I hope that we can move them expeditiously out of our full committee in the near future. So thank you, and I yield back.
Okay, thank you. I'll now introduce our witnesses. So we have the Honorable Stephen R. Lewis, who's governor of the Gila River Indian Community, and Ms. Sarah Obed, Vice President of External Affairs for Doyon Limited. So let me remind the witnesses under our committee rules, they must limit their oral statements to 5 minutes, but their entire statement will appear in the hearing record. And you know the drill on the microphones. They don't come automatically. You must turn on, you will get a green light. After 4 minutes, you get the yellow light, and at the red light, that means what red lights mean. So I ask you to complete your statement at that point, and this will allow everybody to complete their questioning before the witnesses. So let's hear testimony from our witness on H.R. 231. And again, if your testimony is broader, we'll hear the entire statement. We ask you to remain for questions on other measures later in the hearing. Okay? So the chair now recognizes Ms. Obed to testify.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. My name is Sarah Obed, and I'm Athabascan shareholder serving as the Vice President of External Affairs for Doyon Limited. On behalf of Doyon Limited Board of Directors, our 19,700 shareholders and employees, this is a statement of support for the Canyon Village Land Conveyance Act. Doyon is one of 13 Native regional corporations established by Congress under the terms of the Alaska Native Settlement Claims Settlement Act of 1971. Doyon's mission is to promote the economic and social well-being of our present and future shareholders, to strengthen our Native way of life, and to protect and enhance our land and resources. Doyon is the regional corporation for Interior Alaska and is the largest private landowner in Alaska, with a land entitlement under ANCSA of more than 12.5 million acres. Our lands extend from the Brook Range on the north to the Alaska Range on the south. The Alaska-Canada border forms the eastern border, and the western portion almost reaches Norton Sound. Our lands also include the area covering the original Canyon Village land selections, and as such, Doyon Limited is a strong supporter of the introduction and passage of legislation authorizing the conveyance of these lands to the Native people of Canyon Village. Members of Canyon Village continue to hold their traditional site at Canyon Village of historical and cultural importance and have long advocated for their land selections authorized by ANCSA. In meetings between Doyon and shareholders who represent Canyon Village and Cayenne Trail Village Corporation over the last 40 years, we note the consistency in their position despite decades of frustration. Recognized by Congress as a Native village subject to ANCSA, Canyon Village was originally established in 1962 on vacant and unappropriated federal land located on the Porcupine River in Northeast Alaska, by Alaska Natives from Fort Yukon who wished to live an independent subsistence lifestyle. The Bureau of Indian Affairs subsequently certified Cayenne Trail Corporation as the Native Group Corporation for Canyon Village. And in June 1976, Cayenne Trail Corporation filed its land selection with the Bureau of Land Management, the BLM, pursuant to Section 14H2 of ANCSA for conveyance to the Native Group. Regrettably, due to a series of events outside of their control, for 40 years now, the Athabascan people of Canyon Village have been denied the benefit of the settlement of Aboriginal land claims provided for by ANCSA. First, in 1965, BLM withdrew the Aboriginal lands in and around Canyon Village as part of a power site classification for the then proposed Rampart Dam project on the Yukon River. Then in 1980, the Alaska National Interest Lands Conservation Act, otherwise known as ANILCA, expanded the boundary of the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge, known as ANWR, to include the land surrounding Canyon Village. Although the dam project was abandoned well before 1980, the federal government's delay in formally revoking the withdrawal for that project, which did not happen until 1990, prevented the completion of the conveyance in the intervening years before the lands were included in the refuge. Furthermore, the unauthorized and mistaken relinquishment in 1977 by the federal town site trustee of a nearly 300-acre tract included in Canyon Village approved town site petition resulted in the relinquishment of all but 30 acres of the original application. The erroneous relinquishment on behalf of the agency representative was made in the mistaken belief that those lands would be made a part of the Canyon Village ANCSA entitlement. The relinquishment of the town site petition only adds to the unfortunate circumstances that the Alaska Native founders of Canyon Village and their descendants have suffered in their efforts to obtain ownership of their native lands. As a result of these actions and inactions, Cayenne Trey is today one of only two certified Alaska Native group corporations in Alaska that neither has a conveyance nor a pending conveyance arranged by special legislation or negotiation. The particular land selected by the group in 1976 remain a significant cultural and historical relevance and the importance to the remaining founders, very few, unfortunately, who may live to see their Aboriginal lands returned to their people and to their descendants. As a result of the unique circumstances that have stood in the way of the conveyance, legislation's necessary for these lands to be conveyed. I also have, for the record, resolutions and letters of support for this bill from Tanana Chiefs Conference, the Alaska Native Village Corporation Association, and from the Canyon Village Chief.
All right. I thank the witness for her testimony. Remind members of the committee, Rule 3D imposes a 5-minute limit on questions. The chair will now recognize members for questions. And I'm going to go ahead and yield my time to Chairman Emeritus, Mr. Young.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Especially thank you for having us here today. And I think, though small, a very important piece of legislation. And Sarah, thank you for your testimony. This has been an ongoing battle for a long, long time. And really, you bring some history into it about setting aside land for a dam and then have the refuge increased in size and surrounding land that belonged historically to a group of people that should be recognized, and that's really what this bill does. I don't know whether you can do it or not, but is there a question about the legal basis of why this bill includes language that allows Doyon to receive subsurface rights concurrent to Canyon Village receiving land?
For Doyon to receive the subsurface? Yeah, so the law was written, written as it was written in ANCSA. Basically, when a village or a group selected and received their allotted acreage in ANCSA, the regional corporation also received the subsurface rights to those areas.
And that, Sarah, is important to me because there's a lot of dispute about that with some other villages in the state of Alaska. But the corporations, their main income comes from resources that are subsurface, if there's any value to them. And I've seen outside groups try to stop the development of surface development on lands that really belong to them, a subsurface. Doyon has supported this, I think, from the very get-go. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. And you know a lot about this, but I guess if I was asking you one thing, the time frame as far as the Department of Interior, has it been the BLM or Fish and Wildlife? Who's been the biggest bugaboo as far as getting this done?
I don't know if I can answer that question directly. I think there was efforts on behalf of the Department of Interior to look at resolution, and because it's in a refuge, there's no direct resolution without support from Congress.
What I'm leading up to, I think we got a new sheriff in town, and this is an important transfer. It's not that much land. It's a very small portion of land they should have been transferred and settled the Claims Act of 71. Remember, this is 2018, and we passed the act in 71, and if I add that up, that's just about, what, 20, 39 years, or a little better? I'm not sure. 49 years? I don't know. But it's quite a while. So I want to get this done. And, Mr. Chairman, thank you. This, as I said, is a small area with small amount of land, but it affects a group of people that deserve this land. And let's just move this legislation go forth. To my knowledge, other than maybe the Department of Interior oppose it, so far they've been quiet. I think it's a good idea. So with that, I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Young. I always lose a decade when I add up years, too, as that 2000, 2010 doesn't add. So anyway, I now recognize, at the request of our ranking member, we'll go down to Mr. Soto, 5 minutes.
I'm waiting my time for right now.
Okay. Then we'll come back to Mr. Gallego. That's all on you for a ranking member. Okay. All right. So, Mr. Bergman. Wow. Okay. Well, then everybody loves the bill.
I don't want to wait another 65 years, whatever it is.
May I say, you will all be awarded in heaven.
Alaskan heaven.
Alaskan heaven. Very cool.
All right. Well, then I'll close it out here. I'll just have a couple of quick thoughts here to clarify. For Ms. Obed, under the bill, the Doyon may make an alternative selection for its subsurface land instead of accepting the subsurface land to the land conveyed to Canyon Village. So has Doyon had a chance to identify what land it might select under this alternative selection if it chooses to do so?
That's a good question. Under INCSA, Doyon was eligible to receive 12.5 million acres. Not all of those lands have yet to be conveyed, and they are prioritized. So we would probably go to according to what's been prioritized. But I don't have a specific land selection for you today.
Yeah, okay. That can be decided in the future, I'm sure. So you noted that Canyon Village has strong cultural and historic connections to the 1976 selections. Would you care to elaborate any more on that in our remaining time?
I would just point out that I did fly to Fort Yukon a couple of years ago and met with representatives from Canyon Village and have been coordinating with them and letting them know about the legislative process. And I did meet with their traditional leader, Stanley Jonas, who is now in his 80s. And he's been a lifelong advocate of getting these land selections conveyed. And the current chief of Canyon Village, Delmuth Fields, has renewed hope in the future of Canyon Village with the introduction of this bill. And I've included her letter for the record.
Okay, I appreciate that. With that, yes, sir.
Chairman, would you yield? Just a sideline, I'm one of the few people that is Caucasian has been in Canyon Village. When it first started up, there was Richard Martin, Dickie Carroll, family named Jonas. There's really basically three families that were there. And I went up there to hunt caribou. They happened to be right close to what we call the canyon where the caribou cross. I never spent a better night listening to people that knew the caribou and stories that were told because of the constant desire to tell a better story has been told. I think we've all been there. But the next day I was able to go out, and we were subsistence hunting, went out and got our fair share of caribou, but it was a good memory of being in Canyon Village, and it's a well-deserved area, and the people that started this whole many, many, many years ago, for once will have the title to their land. So again, thank you.
Thank you for that. So, well, with that, we'll conclude on this bill. And so, best wishes to the author, and of course, Ms. Obed. Thank you for your time and travel and testimony on this measure. And so thank you. And we'll excuse me. We'll now move on to testimony for. on our bill HR 4032. Again, if it's broader than just the bill, we'll hear the entire statement and ask you to remain for questions on other measures later in the hearing, which isn't really applicable, I don't think, today. So, the chair now recognizes Governor Lewis to testify. Thank you.
Chairman LaMalfa, Ranking Member Torres, thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I'm Stephen Rowe Lewis, the governor of the Gila River Indian Community. We are a federally recognized tribe of over 21,000 tribal members located near Phoenix. I am here today to testify in support of HR 4032. This bill is critical legislation that is necessary to enable the community to obtain the full benefits of the settlement the community reached with the United States to resolve claims for mismanagement of community trust resources. We filed suit in 2006 and then immediately agreed to negotiate a settlement with the United States to find a practical solution to address the community's claims. In particular, the claims that we as a community were most eager to resolve and which this legislation addresses were claims related to undocumented federal rights of way and claims related to the failure of the United States to protect the territorial boundaries of the community's reservation. With respect to undocumented federal rights of way, HR 4032 will provide a process to document and legitimize existing federal rights of way on our lands that once complete will remove long-standing barriers to housing development and implementation of our water settlement. As part of its trust obligations, the United States has a duty to ensure that tribal trust property is protected, preserved, and properly managed. Among other duties, the United States must document all interests and ownership of trust property. In our suit, we alleged, among other things, that the United States failed in these duties to the community with respect to documenting many of the Bureau of Indian Affairs roads, electrical transmission lines, and irrigation infrastructure that cross the reservation. Approximately 3,600 acres of undocumented rights of way affect allotted and tribal trust land on our reservation. Rather than litigate the case in federal court, we entered into settlement negotiations with the United States. The settlement discussions resulted in a global settlement that included a $12.5 million payment from the United States for damages and this settlement legislation. Although restitution was important, what is more important is fixing the problem of undocumented federal rights of way on our reservation. The lack of documentation for these rights of way is an obstacle we deal with on a daily basis. The community has an acute housing shortage on its reservation, and efforts to solve this problem have been slowed by the lack of documentation for existing BIA roads and electrical transmission lines. We are also experiencing difficulty in rehabbing federal canals as part of our water settlement. Due to the lack of documentation for many of these canals, the BIA has taken the position that additional payments need to be made to gain access to these canals. However, the Bureau of Reclamation, which oversees the rehabilitation project, has taken the position that our water settlements funds cannot be used to acquire rights of way for existing infrastructure. These contrary positions have resulted in delays in rehabilitating our irrigation infrastructure and frustrate the implementation of our water settlement. This bill solves these problems by approving a process to establish and confirm all of the federal rights of way on the reservation through surveys conducted by the BIA. HR 4032 also settles a dispute involving the northwest boundary of the reservation along the Salt River by fixing it so as to avoid any disputes with the landowners to our north. The executive order that established the northwest part of the reservation identified the midpoint of the Salt River as the community's northwest boundary. Due to a number of surveying errors in the late 1800s and a lack of diligence to correct those errors in the early 1900s, lands were patented to non-Indian settlers to the north of the community that included parts of our reservation. As a result, there was a title dispute between the community and other parties, including the city of Phoenix. As part of this settlement, we agreed to a fixed boundary in order to avoid any future title dispute. Because we would be losing part of our reservation lands, we were only willing to agree to the fixed boundary if the United States supported an effort to have replacement lands placed into trust. We are seeking to purchase BLM disposal lands that are adjacent to the community and then have these lands placed into trust under this legislation. These lands are culturally important to the community. Because of their cultural importance, we have no plans to develop these lands and have agreed to a ban on any gaming eligibility as a condition to placing these lands into trust. In conclusion, HR 4032 is a critical part of the community settlement, and we look forward to its prompt consideration. Thank you for allowing me to testify, and I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
All right, thank you, Chairman Lewis. Members, we have the 5-minute limit on that, and we're asking questions strictly on HR 4032. So I'll recognize myself first. Chairman Lewis, again, thank you. The legislation prohibits gaming to be conducted on the 3,400 acres in question that would be placed into trust. With this prohibition, does the community have plans for other types of development on the lands that you know of or are planning?
Chairman, of course, the community has no plans to develop these lands. The lands in the Estrella Mountain Range are especially culturally and historically significant to the Gila River Indian Community. In January of 2017, the Gila River Indian Community passed a resolution designating the Estrella Mountain Range as a sacred place and traditional cultural property of the Gila River Indian Community. The sole purpose for reacquiring these lands is to preserve the lands for traditional purposes and ensure that future generations have the benefit and access to this sacred place.
Okay, very nice. Thank you. That makes sense. You mentioned in your statement that due to the delayed and improper survey of the community's northwestern boundary, it resulted in lands being patented to non-Indians, which is very problematic. So how many acres of land has the community estimated it lost due to this improper survey procedure?
We've lost at least 600 acres of land, Chairman.
Okay, all right, very good. Well, this should be a fairly quick one here. The community filed its lawsuit during the Bush administration against the U.S. The settlement was reached during the Obama administration in 2016. Does the Trump administration support the settlement as we finish this process?
Yes, the Trump administration currently supports this, and although the Department of Interior couldn't be here today to testify, the community has worked with his administration and believe once this legislation is enacted that they will move quickly to the implementation phase of the settlement, Chairman.
Well, nicely done, spanning three administrations who have that agreement and different ideas in each. So, okay. So, lastly, what we have is the failure on the having an accurate survey on that boundary is a big part of it. Now, what I wonder, would it be more beneficial to complete those surveys by the BIA before the rest of the legislation would take effect, so that we have an accurate survey of what we're dealing with before the legislation tries to be specific or even non-specific on that without the survey? What do you think about that?
Well, I guess taking into account, and part of this is utilizing the land into trust process under the Indian Reorganization Act, and then that's I think part of the context of your question. And under the Arizona Water Settlement Act, the community can only have lands located outside the exterior boundaries of its reservation, of course, placed into trust by the Act of Congress. The community is bound by this act. That's why we are thankful for this hearing, and hopeful that this committee will take quick action to move this bill to the full committee and through the House of Representatives. This process first started, as was noted earlier, in 2006, and it took a lot of time and resources and negotiations to reach the place where we're at today. And so we hope this committee will work with us to ensure the legislation is passed so we can, again, move to the implementation of the settlement. Mr. Chairman.
All right, thank you for that. I'll end my time here and recognize our ranking member, Ms. Torres.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Governor Lewis, congratulations on your reelection as governor. In your written testimony, you state that the problem with undocumented federal rights of way is not unique to the Gila River Indian community, and that H.R. 4032 is an innovative solution to that problem. How could other tribes who have similar issues work with the federal government to ensure that they're able to move in the right direction and not have to take as long as you had that lengthy process that you had to go through?
Thank you, Ranking Member Torres. You know, the uncertainty that the Gila River Indian community faced because of the inability to locate the legal documentation and substantiate a large number of the federal rights-of-way or easements on the reservation is something that impacts tribes all across Indian country. And this lack of documentation and inadequate processes were not created by the tribes but continue to have a significant impact on the ability of tribal nations to provide for the basic infrastructure needs, such as housing, roads, and irrigation. So we think this legislation, once enacted, may serve as an impetus for other tribal nations to engage in a nation-to-nation dialogue to address these issues related to undocumented rights of way in their tribal communities. For tribal nations, the preference is always to engage as governments with the federal government and avoid costly litigation, which takes resources away from our tribal communities and their citizens.
Should there be an established fund to help assist with the costs associated with surveying tribal land to ensure that we move in the right direction and begin to clarify where your territory begins and ends?
Chairman LaWaffa, Ranking Member Torres, tribes across Indian country have different levels of ability to defend and advocate for themselves in regards to resources. So this fund would definitely benefit a large number of tribes throughout Indian country, and that would be a right in the right direction.
Right. I'm just thinking as we begin to have conversations around an infrastructure bill that, we look for opportunities like this to correct missing information that we have or inaccurate information that we may have so that the rights of tribes are not don't continue to be encroached on simply because there is no document behind what is yours and what belongs to state governments or the federal government.
Chairman LaMalfa, Ranking Member Torres, I think that goes, that type of a proposal or opportunity really goes, I think, and supports that trust responsibility with the federal government to the tribes. I think that would be a tremendous step forward for tribes to be able to have that ability and those resources.
Thank you, and I'll yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Torres. I'll recognize Mr. Soto for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Governor, I find it disheartening that we're still cleaning up after President Rutherford B. Hayes's order of 1879. I don't know what more I could say about how long of a struggle and how depressing it is that you all have to keep fighting for this when we're talking about over 100 years. But I'm glad that I see bipartisan support from your delegation. And so I'm looking forward to supporting the bill here today. And sorry that it's taken this long.
Thank you, Representative Soto, for those remarks.
All right, Mr. Gallego, 5 minutes.
I'd like to start by thanking Chairman LaMalfa and Ranking Member Torres for holding this hearing on H.R. 4032, the Gila River Indian Community Federal Rights-of-Way, Easements, and Boundary Clarification Act. I'm a co-sponsor and a proud neighbor of the Gila River Indian Community, actually just living about a mile down from the community, and they are great neighbors and great Arizonans. I'm a strong sponsor and supporter of this bipartisan legislation that will provide important clarity and address longstanding ambiguity regarding the community's northwest boundary, which I'm very familiar with living as close as I do, and offer certainty to the landowners who reside in the proximity to it. So before we begin questions, I'd like to highlight the breadth of stakeholder engagement that happened throughout this process and memorialize a broad support for H.R. 4032. So first of all, I ask for consent to submit the following documents for the record. Number one, a letter from the City of Phoenix to Chairman LaMaffa and Ranking Member Torres supporting H.R. 4032 and its clarifying impacts. And two, a letter from Maricopa County Board of Supervisors to Representative Gosar indicating their finding of no conflict with the proposed settlement. Both of these governmental entities are the ones that have overlapping boundaries with the Gila River Indian Community.
Without objection.
Thank you. And to provide additional context regarding the tribe's connection to the lands in question, there's a letter from the Gila River Indian Community's Tribal Preservation Officer to the subcommittee chairman and ranking member detailing some of the tribe's historical and cultural connections to the land in question, as well as their intent to preserve the land. And finally, the Gila River Indian Community's resolution designated the Estrella Mountains, part of which will be taken to trust with this settlement, as a sacred place of cultural importance.
Without objection.
Thank you. Governor, thank you for traveling from Arizona to be here. We should have carpooled to the airport at least. It'd be good environmentalists next time. Based on your testimony, this legislation would have positive impacts not only on the Gila River Indian Community, but also for the surrounding communities. Can you describe how local landowners and local governments feel about this legislation?
Thank you, Representative Gallego. Yes, the legislation would resolve any potential boundary disputes on the northwest boundary of the community's reservation along the Salt River. This would bring certainty, not only to the community, but to the landowners residing on that boundary. Although the settlement is between the community and the federal government, we have kept the local governments informed of the progress and outcome of those negotiations. I believe you've heard from several members of the Phoenix City Council who are eager to see H.R. 4032 passed so boundary disputes can be resolved. In addition, the chairman of the Maricopa County Board of Supervisors also submitted a letter for this hearing stating no issue with the legislation as presented. This level of support is due to the continued dialogue between the Gila River Indian community and our neighbors, and the need for certainty over the reservation boundary for the tribe and the local community.
Thank you, Governor. And could you explain to everyone here why this settlement is important, why the land in question is important, both obviously the land along the Tres Rios area as well as the Estrella Mountain. I know it, you know it, and we live there, we see how beautiful they are, but I think it's also important for us to get the perspective of why this is important to the Gila River Indian community itself.
Thank you, Chairman LaMaffa, Congressman Gallego. This is such a long-standing issue. This goes back, of course, to the creation of the community's reservation boundaries that were inaccurately mapped. And, of course, this led to this Tres Rios issue where this really became a no man's land of jurisdictional issues, safety issues, public safety issues, and cultural issues as well. And the community has always maintained a concept of being good neighbors. And although this at times put a strain on our relationship between the City of Phoenix and the county, we've always worked collaboratively, to work toward this. And I think we're at a point now where this potentially will finally be resolved as well. And of course, the land in question that the community hopes to purchase from the Bureau of Land Management, that is, those are sacred sites there to us, culturally and spiritually relevant sites that we want to preserve for future members and generations of our community. To bring that land into trust and back to our community, that is something that our elders have been waiting for. That is something that our children will benefit from in the future in regards to keeping our cultural and spiritual ties to this land. Representative Gallego, thank you for that question. Yep.
Thank you, Governor, and thank you to you and your tribal members for being such great neighbors and working and having patience with us. Thank you, Chairman.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Mr. Gallego. And Governor Lewis, I again appreciate your testimony and your time and travel here today. And certainly there's issues that need to be resolved here and expeditiously. Rutherford B. Hayes isn't a name that gets used very often around here. And somehow I remember that middle initial, I think, accurately, but not really a funny situation. We clarity is deserved there, and so your testimony and your efforts and all those that have aligned with you certainly make a strong case for achieving a result here. So again, thank you for your time and for perseverance. So with that, we have, where are we at here? Okay. The members of the committee may have additional questions for the witnesses, and we'll ask you to respond to those in writing for those here today. Under Committee Rule 3-0, members of the committee must submit witness questions within 3 business days following the hearing by 5 p.m. And the hearing record will be held open for 10 business days for those responses. So if there's no further business, without objection, the subcommittee stands adjourned.